Hello, I'm Deanna. Welcome to Creekside Online. The Harvest Festival is this Sunday from 5 to 8:30 p.m. Invite your friends and neighbors and join us for a fun night of carnival games, entertainment, and candy. Starting this Tuesday, we have a three-week course led by Dr. Bev Weens, professor and director of counseling at Western Seminary. In this class, we'll be discussing the developmental stage of children and biblical theology of sexuality. This class is just $15 per family, and childcare is available for only $10 per child for all 3 weeks. On Sunday, November 14th, we'll be hosting a fall concert and homeless benefit. The concert will be featuring Benita Jones, who is an accomplished singer and songwriter with hits that have reached the top spots on Billboard and gospel charts. For admission, please bring an item for the homeless: coats, beanies, hats, gloves, hand warmers, and socks, to give you a few ideas. The concert starts at 5 p.m. and doors open at 4 p.m. For more information, visit our website. The annual Samaritan's Purse Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Drive is going on right now. Filling a shoebox with small toys, hygiene items, and school supplies helps share the good news of Jesus Christ with children around the world. While supplies last, you can pick up a free shoebox to fill and return no later than November 14th in our atrium. For more information, visit our website. We want to remind you that next Sunday, November 7th, is daylight savings time. We'll be falling back, so remember to change your clocks. If this is your first time joining us online, we'd love to call you and say hello. Text the word guest to 888-111 and someone will contact you. If you need prayer, you can text the words need prayer to 888-111 and someone will reach out to pray with you. And if you'd like to give to Creekside, you can text the word give to the number here on your screen. Let's worship together.
we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
All right, joy in the house of the Lord. Well, have you had a God moment recently? Is there a place you recognize his movement in your life or in the situation around you? We're going to sing here in a minute about so many reasons we have to praise God and to bless him with our souls. And for all your goodness, we're going to sing this. For all your goodness, I'll keep on singing 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So have you found any reasons recently? Have you seen anything recently in your life? This week, we had a God moment, and I don't know, it's a happy, sad thing. Sometimes, you know, we have so many challenges in life, and we can focus on the difficult things, and yet God is at work in those too often, right? And so this week we commemorated just a really special person in the life of our family. So the ministry of Camp Barnabas, you may be familiar with Camp Barnabas. Many people from Creekside have gone. Maybe you've gone or you know someone that's gone. It's a wonderful ministry. In Missouri, and it's a Christian camp for kids with special needs of various kinds. And in the summer, kids come with all different kinds of disabilities and wheelchairs, kids that are blind, have hearing issues, all kinds of different issues, and they just receive love and have an awesome week at camp. And my wife served there for a number of summers, and she made a really special friend there, PJ, Pamela Jean. We call her PJ, the Peach. We just love her, and she met her as a girl, and then as she grew up, she was part of our family, was in our wedding as a junior bridesmaid and would come in the summers and visit. And we just had an amazing time with her. And she shone Jesus Christ, just emanated from her. She walked with Jesus, and you think of the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience. She like displayed all of those in her life and really was an example to us of what a Christ follower looks like in person. Even though she suffered from muscular dystrophy, and she had really thin arms, and she had a little scooter, you know, wheelchair and scooter that she was in. And anyway, when she was 17 on a Tuesday morning, Jesus took her home, her senior year of high school, and we grieved that loss, and we went to Kansas, and where she was from, and here we were in a gymnasium with thousands of people that were honoring her at her memorial service, and she'd impacted her local high school and just was a light for Jesus on that campus. And this song we're about to sing, Bless the Lord, O My Soul, was sung, and beautiful and haunting, and I couldn't sing it for a long time after that. It was just too closely connected to the loss of our PJ that we loved, and it was hard, you know, for my soul to do it. But time went on, and God heals, and one of the beautiful things, we developed a really sweet relationship with her parents and her siblings, and that has continued to deepen. And this week, as we honored the day, it was the anniversary of her passing this week, we were on the phone with her mom and just encouraging each other in the Lord. She was just pouring into us, reading scripture. We were pouring into her. It was just this beautiful, beautiful time. And God moved, even though it's a difficult thing. God brought some beauty. He certainly brought beauty through PJ's life to us and to so many. And we rejoice that we have great hope we're going to see her again. She's dancing with Jesus, no longer confined to the wheelchair. And so in the challenge of our lives, we find God moving and working. So where do you see it? Where do you see it in your life? Where is God moving? How is he changing things? How is he speaking to your heart? just ponder that as we sing this song. We're going to sing the song. We're going to bless him. We're going to bless the Lord, oh my soul, and sing about all those reasons. So just ponder that as we sing together. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up.
Hi, my name is Andrew Pack. I am the college and young adult pastor here, and I have the privilege of bringing the word today. Well, today is the start of a new series called Unity, where we are covering the three critical things that unite us as a church, which is the Word of God and the sacraments of baptism and communion. And I'm really excited for this short series because unity is in short supply in this day and age, is it not? And yet, Jesus has called us as the body of Christ, his church, to be unified together as one people. And therefore, it's important for us as the church to know what actually unites us together. And this series, I think, will help us to do that. And I had the honor and privilege of starting off this series by covering our unity as a church underneath the Word of God. And in God's providence, we are getting to cover this on Halloween. Now, for some, Halloween is an exciting holiday that means getting to dress up in a funny costume and eat lots of candy. And for others, Halloween is maybe viewed with some suspicion because it seems to have some weird origins. And also sometimes those kids who can go around trick-or-treating can get just a little bit annoying. And I can see the perspectives of both groups, honestly. But personally, I love Halloween. And really, I love it because of something that really has nothing to do with dressing up or eating candy or anything to do with the holiday itself. The reason I love Halloween is because 500 years ago, something happened on Halloween that is arguably the reason that a place like Creekside, and in fact, all Protestant and evangelical churches today exist. Because on October 31st, 1517, the German Augustinian monk Martin Luther pinned his 95 theses on the door of the castle church in Wittenberg, Germany, as an act of defiance against the corruption within the Catholic Church at the time. And when he did that, he sparked the Protestant Reformation, and he changed the course of human history forever. If Martin Luther had not boldly pinned his 95 theses on the door of the castle church those 502 years ago, it's safe to say that you and I, we may not be sitting here today. And yet, something that I've often found is that many people in the church today don't even know who Martin Luther is. And if they do know who he is, they're often fuzzy at best on the reasons why he did what he did to spark the Protestant Reformation. So why did Martin Luther speak up against the Catholic Church? You know, in order to understand the answer to that question, we first have to understand a little bit about Martin Luther and his life. Before Luther became a Christian monk, he was studying to be a lawyer in the early 16th century. And one day when he was traveling on the road by horseback, a huge lightning storm came upon him. And in the middle of the storm, a terrified Luther cried out to God for mercy and promised that if God spared his life, he would commit his life to serving him. Well, Luther did survive. God did spare his life. And one semester shy of becoming a lawyer, he dropped out of his studies and joined the priesthood, much to the dismay of his parents. I mean, parents, imagine if you had a kid in college and he was about to graduate in 1 year and then he decides that he's gonna choose a completely different career path. So for over 10 years, Luther studied theology and the Bible as a Roman Catholic Augustinian monk. And this was a time of severe spiritual depression for Luther. Luther's conscience was a very sensitive one. He would often spend hours in confession, anxious that if he neglected to confess one of his sins before an untimely death, that he would be condemned to hell or would extend his time in purgatory. There's this one story of on a particular evening when he was in a time of confession with his friend and Augustinian mentor, Johann von Staupitz, that after several hours of prayer and confession, Staupitz dismissed Luther for the night, thinking that was the end of it. And only minutes later, Luther returned to Staupitz's room, knocking on his door frantically, wanting to confess any sin that may have happened in the few minutes that occurred since Luther left him. I mean, obviously, Luther had some issues. Johann von Staupitz, seeing this in Luther, and out of compassion for his apprentice, he eventually commissioned Luther to go and to study and to learn how to read the Bible in the original languages of Greek and Hebrew, thinking to give Luther an activity that would perhaps distract him from his depression and despair and that it would help to give him a dignifying challenge to lift his spirits. And so he sent Luther away to do this, and study Luther did. And it was in Luther's intensive study of the scriptures, particularly as he read the books of Romans and Galatians and Hebrews, that Luther underwent an incredible transformation. Because as he read the Bible for the first time, he realized that the scriptures don't teach that you can be right with God based on your works of confession or penance. But he realized that the scriptures taught that it was simply by faith in Jesus Christ and his grace alone that we are saved. Listen to what Luther writes in his introduction to his commentary on the book of Romans. He said, "I hated that word, the righteousness of God, by which I had been taught according to the custom and use of all the teachers, that God is righteous and punishes the unrighteous sinner. You ask me if I love God? Sometimes I hated him. I saw Christ as a consuming judge who is simply looking at me to evaluate me and to visit affliction upon me. But at last, meditating day and night by the mercies of God, I began to understand that the righteousness of God is that through which the righteous live by a gift of God, namely by faith. Here I felt as if I were entirely born again and had entered paradise itself through the gates that had been flung open." It was when Luther began to truly read scripture for himself and understand the gospel therein that his life changed forever. And then in 1517, the Catholic Church began to push the sale of indulgences, which is essentially the slip of paper that the Pope and the Catholic Church at the time would sell that said that it would reduce your time in purgatory and help you to gain approval from God if you purchased it. And when Luther heard about this, Luther was livid. Because for Luther, the sale of these indulgences was nothing less than treason against the Bible and the gospel itself. And so he got a nail and he got a hammer, and voila. You and I are here today. In the Protestant Reformation, there were five major phrases that would come to define the values of Protestantism and evangelicalism. And they're called the five solas. There's sola Christus, Christ alone, that only Jesus can save and redeem us and is worthy of our worship. There's sola gratia and sola fide, grace alone and faith alone, that only our faith alone in God's grace alone is what can save us and make us acceptable before God. Then there's sola de gloria, which is for the glory of God alone, that our salvation by God's grace through faith is meant to bring utmost glory to God. But the sola which undergirds and supports all the other solas, all the other values, is actually sola scriptura, scripture alone. Or in other words, sola scriptura says that it is scripture alone that has the authority to show us who Jesus is, what grace and faith is. Scripture alone has the authority to tell us how we can be saved and what it means to walk faithfully with Jesus. Because remember, how did Martin Luther realize that it is only by faith in the grace of God alone that we could be saved in Christ? How did Martin Luther realize what the gospel truly was? And how did he have the boldness and the courage to stand up for this truth when almost the entire Catholic Church was standing against him, threatening him with excommunication, torture, and death? How was he able to do this? The answer, he read scripture. Brothers and sisters, as a gospel-believing, gospel-proclaiming church here at Creekside, we are only as strong and faithful as our strength and commitment to knowing, following, and obeying the Word of God. And if we are going to walk faithfully with Jesus Christ and to bear witness to His glory and His gospel in our community, then we must be unified in our devotion to His Word. Listen to what Jesus prayed for us believers in John 17, 14 through 18 in the upper room. He said, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified in truth. Jesus has given us the word of God, has prayed that we would be sanctified in the truth of his word. And just as Jesus was sent into the world by his Father, he is seeking to send us out to the world as word of God saturated and word of God sanctified people. And that should put a fire in our bones to know this word. Someone who perhaps illustrates the centrality of the word of God better than anyone is the Apostle Paul himself, which makes sense because the Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write over a third of the New Testament. And I'd like us to look at what he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17. He says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, ready for every good work. You know, from this passage, we can see Paul saying three truths about the centrality of God's word in the life of the church. First, that the word of God teaches and instructs us. Second, that the word of God convicts and corrects us. And third, that the word of God trains and equips us. So first, the word of God teaches and instructs us. Notice in verses 14 through 15 how Paul reminds Timothy of his spiritual formation in God's word. He says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. What these verses show us is that Timothy was steeped in Scripture. He had learned it, and not just learned it recently, but from childhood. He had more than likely had many good and faithful teachers, both from his family and from within the church. And he hadn't just learned about Scripture or about the gospel nonchalantly. He had firmly believed it. He had firmly internalized it for himself, presumably over careful and arduous study. Or in other words, Timothy wasn't just some talented, hyper-spiritual individual that you and I could never live up to. Timothy was taught and was instructed and was discipled in the Word of God over years. And he was who he was on account of that immersion into the Word of God. So how do Paul's words to Timothy about his spiritual formation in the Word of God challenge us today? You know, it sounds simple, but I think that if this passage shows us anything, it's that the Word of God actually, really, does have to be taught. And the Word of God really does have to be learned. It's not a step that you can skip or that you can expedite, but rather churches must be committed and relentless in teaching and instructing the people of God in the Word of God. And brothers and sisters, if you want to be a serious Christian, then you must be about the business of learning and studying the Word of God. Now some of you may be thinking, okay, Andrew, I am serious about my faith. I do love Jesus. I want to follow him. But I'm not some Bible scholar. I'm not an expert in Hebrew or Greek. I'm not a history buff. Heck, I'm not even good at analyzing the English version of my Bibles. I just want to know how to be able to read this book well enough to apply it to my life. To which my response is, me too. I also want you to be able to read this book well enough to apply it to your life. But listen, what we all need to recognize is that applying the Word of God actually requires diligently learning and deeply knowing this Word. When I was a Bible teacher at a Christian high school, something I used to tell my students at the beginning of the school year all the time was that I didn't want them to just simply learn information or to simply just learn terms. But I wanted them to have a real passion for the scriptures and to know how to truly apply the scriptures to their life. And because I wanted that, I promised them, hey, listen, guys, I'm not going to give you busy work. And the students, whenever they would hear that, they seemed to really appreciate hearing that from me. And it's also probably why they were just a little bit confused when I did make them learn a bunch of information. And I expected them to memorize verses and context and historical facts about the Bible. And every once in a while, a student who was maybe feeling lazy or didn't want to spend time learning the information, they would always bring up what I said at the beginning of the year. They'd say, Mr. Pack, I thought you said you weren't going to give us busy work. And that you didn't just want us to know information and terms. Well, guess what? There's a lot of information and terms in here. And my response would always be the same. I would say, first of all, it isn't busy work if it's actually something you need to learn. And second, developing a passion for the scriptures and knowing how to apply the scriptures to your life, it is certainly more than learning information in terms, but it is also not less. In fact, application without information always leads to misdirection. Brothers and sisters, if you want to properly apply the truth, you first need to know the content of that truth. And listen, we all know this. I mean, imagine you were buying a home for the first time and you hired a real estate agent to help you. No good real estate agent would say, hey man, look, I'm not really interested in learning the ins and outs of the market or the different kinds of houses in particular neighborhoods or areas or the various kinds of home loans and how they differentiate from one another or how they could affect your credit. Those are for the brainy agents. I'm just concerned with closing the deal as quickly as possible. If an agent said that to you and you were serious about looking for a house, you would get another agent, would you not? And you would be right too. The same goes for almost anything. If a musician on the worship team, no matter how talented they are, if they showed up to practice and didn't bother practicing or learning any of the songs, then Peter Newman would probably not have them play. If you invited someone to be a part of your fantasy football league and they didn't know any of the rules of football or they didn't know any of the terminology or they didn't know any of the teams or they didn't know any of the players, and they aren't really that concerned with learning any of those things, you'd probably be tempted to ask them not to be in your league anymore. Yet somehow with Christianity, so many Christians think that serious and deep study of the Word of God isn't really all that important or necessary, or that it's only the calling of a select few. And the result is that we have many, many Christians who are more formed and more discipled and guided by their culture or their politics or their social media feeds than we have Christians that are formed by God's Word. And the result of that is division and disunity, because our standards and priorities, they end up all being different from one another on account of these things. An article I read recently on the breaking apart of many evangelical churches in our nation, it put it like this, and I quote, "What we're seeing in many evangelical churches today is massive discipleship failure caused by a massive failure to teach God's word. Meanwhile, culture teaches us what matters and what views we should take about what matters. It has multiple technologies and platforms for teaching us: television, radio, Facebook, Twitter, and podcasts among them. People who want to be connected to their social or political tribe, the people that think like them or the people that they think are on their side, subject themselves to its teachings all day long, every single day, hour after hour after hour. On the flip side, many churches aren't interested in teaching at all. They focus instead on entertainment because entertainment is what keeps people in their seats and coins in the offering plate. But even those pastors who really are committed to teaching get to spend, on average, less than an hour a week teaching their people. Sermons are short. Only some churchgoers attend adult education classes, and even fewer attend Bible study and small groups. Yet cable news, computer monitors, and Twitter and Facebook feeds are always on. Listen, I'm not advocating that we start having hour-long sermons. But here's a question for all of us to consider. Does the time that we spend scrolling our social media feeds outweigh the time we spend studying God's word, either individually or with others? Now, I'm going to be really honest with you. I almost deleted that question from my sermon because I didn't want to be a hypocrite. See, often the answer for me is no to that question, when it should be yes, and I'm ashamed to say that. But perhaps God is giving us an opportunity as a church to collectively repent and to commit ourselves to looking at His word far more often than we look at our iPhone or laptop screens. Brothers and sisters, can we commit to doing that together? So the word of God teaches and instructs us, but it doesn't just stop at giving us information, because the word of God also convicts and corrects us. Notice in verse 16 of 2 Timothy 3, it says this: "All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness." Now, those words, reproof and correction, they're often overlooked or glossed over when this verse is read. And yet they are incredibly central, not only to understanding this text, but also to understanding how God often uses His word through the power of the Holy Spirit to convict us and to lead us into truth. Consider what Jesus says in John 16, 8 through 14. Jesus says, "And when He," referring to the Holy Spirit, "comes, He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in Me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father and you will see Me no longer. And concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all truth. For He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify Me, for He will take what is Mine and declare it to you." Jesus is saying some incredible things here. He's saying that we will be given the Holy Spirit, the Helper, the Spirit of truth, who will bring conviction to the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. And He will bring this conviction, how? Verse 13, by leading us into the truth. And so the question naturally arises, okay, so what exactly is the truth that He will be leading us into? And the answer is something I already brought up in the beginning. It's what Jesus says in the next chapter in John 17:17. sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. So let's put those two things together. How and where does the Holy Spirit bring conviction and correction and sanctification to his people? Answer, through the beholding and the trusting and the obeying of the word of God, that the Holy Spirit will actually lead us into the truth of his word. This is why Paul writes in Hebrews 4:12, "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." Friends, when you and I read the Bible, you are not just reading Scripture. Scripture is also reading you. And eventually, if you read it long enough, Scripture will read something in your life which is out of alignment with what he has spoken. And when that happens, see, the question that all of us have to wrestle with is, will we respond by trying to change the parts of Scripture that are challenging and convicting? Or will we let the parts of Scripture that are challenging and convicting change us? Brothers and sisters, being convicted and corrected is never easy or comfortable. I mean, I've never met a Christian who seriously said, "Man, I just love being convicted and corrected of my sin." It's hard to be convicted and corrected. But it's also harder not to, because your sins will find you out eventually. You know, as a college pastor, I've often sat with a lot of students wrecked with despair and anxiety and shame, because at some point they stopped reading their Bibles. They stopped engaging community and accountability. They stopped feeling convicted of their sin, until eventually they're so numb that they can't even see that there is a problem in their life until it finally blows up in their face. Their girlfriend finds out about their porn addiction. Friendships implode because of anger and resentment. Their double life of partying on the weekend and then trying to look good at church on Sundays or at youth group gets found out. And in those moments, they feel as if their lives are ruined and shattered, and they can't pinpoint where it all started. And yet when you break it down, almost always in every single one of those situations, everything started with ignoring and neglecting this. You know, on the front page of my Bible here, I wrote an inscription that I heard someone say when I was going to Moody. And the inscription says, "This book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book." Another way of saying it is, you'll either respond in repentance and obedience to the conviction and correction that this book brings, or you will choose to reject it. And as we ponder our choices, brothers and sisters, we will do well to remember the words of the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 66:2. "But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and who trembles at my word." Creekside Christian Church, may we be a people who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at the word of the Lord in obedience and in faith. So the word of God teaches and instructs us, and the word of God convicts and corrects us. But lastly, the word of God trains and equips us. Look with me again at verses 16 through 17 in 2 Timothy 3. "All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, ready for every good work." Not only do the scriptures teach us, not only do they reprove and correct us, but ultimately the scriptures train us in righteousness. They don't just tell us what we're doing wrong or what not to do. They train us in how to live as Jesus lived, to walk as Jesus walked, and to glorify him with every facet and every arena in our lives. And for what purpose? Verse 17, that the man of God may be complete, ready for every good work. The Holy Spirit, through his word, has promised to train and to equip you so that you may be complete, complete to walk in holiness, complete to walk in obedience, and complete to fulfill your mission as his spirit-empowered, word-saturated people who bear witness to the gospel and his glory. That's why verses like Philippians 1:6 are so significant. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. How will God bring to completion the good work that he began in you and I? The answer, through his word. And so, brothers and sisters, when we are discouraged, when we are beaten down, when we feel like we keep failing and falling short, in those moments, the answer is not to simply just try harder or to try to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, but it is to remember that the promises of God about his word will stand. That he said in Isaiah 40, verse 8, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. And then later on in Isaiah 55:11, he says, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that for which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. Because the word of God will stand forever, because it never returns empty, but will accomplish the purpose for which it was sent, we can have confidence that God will sanctify and equip us and see us through. Because even though you and I fall short, the word of God stands, and it stands forever. But how do we know that it's true? How do we know that God's promises are unfailing? How do we know that his word really is sure and reliable? Right? Because people say things they don't mean and make promises they don't keep all the time, do they not? So how can we know that God's word can be trusted, that it really is powerful enough and reliable enough to see us through? What makes God any different from us? The answer is that God did not just speak empty and hollow words of promises and salvation to us and then not do anything. He didn't just speak and then not act. But in the person of Jesus Christ, God, the living word, accomplished his promises for us. And God, the living word, came to save us himself. John 1:14 says, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. And then in verse 16, it says, for from his fullness, from the fullness of the word, we have all received grace upon grace. Friends, God's written word is sure because the living word was crucified, was buried, and was raised to life on the third day. And all the promises of Scripture ring true because Jesus Christ himself is living proof, literally, that our God is a God who keeps his promises. Brothers and sisters, may we be people of the Word of God who cling to every word that he has spoken. May we find that the thing that unifies us together as the people of God, as the church, is not our race, it's not our politics, it's not our country of origin, it's not even our culture, but it is our unwavering commitment to God's word and our citizenship in the kingdom of heaven under Jesus Christ. God has spoken. May we have the faith to listen and the resolve to obey, that he may be glorified and that we may receive the joy. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you have spoken, but more than just speaking, Lord, that you, the living word, have stepped down into time, space, and history in the person of Jesus Christ to redeem us, to restore us to yourself. And Lord, when we look at the cross, when we look at the empty tomb, we are assured that the promises of God stand, that your word stands, that the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God stands forever. And when the word goes out, it shall not return void, because your word is not bound. But Lord, it is going forth and producing a harvest of righteousness. Lord, give us the faith to pursue what you have spoken. Give us the faith to obey what you have spoken. And give us the faith, Lord, to be word of God saturated, spirit-filled people who are faithful to that which you have called us and who glorify the name of Jesus in our community. We give you all the glory and the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Word of God, speak, let it pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ of